Deuteronomy 11, 10 through 12, for the land which whither thou goest in to possess, it is not as the land of Egypt from whence ye came out, where thou sowest thy seed and waterest it with thy foot as a garden of herbs. But the land whither you go to possess it is a land of hills and valleys, and drinketh the water of the rain of heaven, a land which the Lord thy God careth for the eyes of the Lord thy God are always upon it from the beginning of the year, even unto the end of the year. Thank you, you may be seated. Thank you for standing in honor of the word. So I want to preach to you tonight that this is not like that. So the land of Egypt, as this is our scripture setting, this is the instructions in Deuteronomy. Joshua and Moses have been in charge of Israel, and Israel has been wandering in the wilderness. They've come up on many promises, and the Lord has revealed to Moses instructions and laws and literally becoming a nation. The Lord took a group of disadvantaged people. I don't know what else you would call them. I guess in modern day vernacular, we would call them slaves or human trafficking or whatever you want to call them, because they were used and abused. They were the labor force. They were put in Egypt by God through the dreams of Pharaoh and a big famine. And I believe it was 70, or I may have my number right, but I believe it was 70 people from the tribe of, from Jacob that went down into Egypt. And now they've been there for a long time, 430 years. And now there has another Pharaoh has risen up that didn't know Joseph, that didn't know the great dreams. All he knows is there's this group of people, and they keep multiplying like rabbits. And there's just a bunch of them, and then we don't know what to do. And all of a sudden, one day, we popped up with, somebody said, you know, if it keeps going like it's going, there's going to be more of them than there are of us. And then what do we do? And the political advisors and the military advisors began to realize, you know what? This is our country, and if we're going to hang on to it, we got to do something about this. And so they began to afflict and to torment and to enslave the children of Israel. And the Bible says the more that Pharaoh would torment or enslave, the more they would multiply. Just a hint, don't mess with God's people. It never works. It just never does. So we have a nation within a nation, or a people that now all they've known for 400 years, there's not a lot of legacy left of what the promised land used to was. Because 400 years later in history, you begin to forget, and they begin to forget to tell you, and grandpa and great-grandpa, and 400 years later, the promised land is something you talk about, but you've never been there, you don't really know about it. But now this guy Moses shows up with a stick that turns into a snake and starts doing crazy stuff. Freaks everybody out, calls frogs, lice, hail. The one that always freaked me out was darkness that could be felt. I don't even know what that is, but it sounds scary. So the plagues are on Egypt, and finally it culminates with the great plague of the Passover, the firstborn. If you don't have the blood on the post and have taken care of your business, the firstborn in your household is dead that night. And with that, Pharaoh says, get out of here. Just go and take whatever you want with you. Just get out of here. And so now this group of people goes out into the wilderness to go into the promised land. And when they get into the promise, when they get into the wilderness, things don't go so good, because they've been living as a slave for so long. Now, there is a fact that you can get trapped in your mind even though your body is free. And so the children of Israel are in the wilderness. God is performing miracles daily. Water shows up. This manna starts falling out of the sky in the morning. You go pick it up. I mean, anybody ever been camping? Got hungry for s'mores and you didn't bring any? Or something like that? Well, there's no Walmart in the desert. You can't run down to the Pizza Hut place and get a stuffed crust pizza. So how do you feed millions of people in the wilderness? It's a miracle. It's God. And so through the process of time, Moses, through the direction of God, begins to tell, hey, we're not slaves anymore. We're a nation. We're chosen by God. God appears to the nation, and Moses begins to write these things down, these laws, these precepts, and he begins to change a culture. And I'm going to tell you, changing a culture is hard to do. But it can be done. But it takes this four-letter word called time. You have to take time to change a culture. And there's no shortcut to it. So as they're getting closer to the land of the promised land, and they're going through the wilderness, before this, the word comes that you need to listen to all the things that I told you. If you want to last very long, all these rules and stuff that I'm giving you, I'm pretty serious about it. Like, don't worship other gods when you go places. You know, do what I told you to do. When you come up on a false altar of Baal or Ashtaroth, cut it down. When you go into the city, wipe them out. I'm not playing about this. Don't worship false gods. And so finally, we get to this setting. For the land where you go in to possess is not as the land of Egypt. Now, the land of Egypt, at this point, remember, they've been in the wilderness, and the people that were 40 years old or older have died in the wilderness. So only the young people that remember Egypt can kind of remember. That's 20, 30, 40 years ago. And so it's becoming a little bit hazy as far as, you know, what you remember from 40 years ago. Anybody remember exactly where you were 40 years ago? Does it get a little fuzzy? Some of you aren't even 40 years old. You hadn't even discovered America 40 years ago. So the land that you're going is not like the land of Egypt, but there's a word there called possess. The land where you're going to possess it, and that makes all the difference, is not as the land of Egypt from whence you came out. I've been on vacations before. I have seen some really cool things. A couple weeks ago, we went to Six Flags. Man, I would love to have a roller coaster like that in my backyard. That would be amazing. But I went there, I paid my admission fee, and then I left. I didn't possess Six Flags because it wasn't mine. So the land now that has been given to the children of Israel, the Lord has given them a, hey, this is a heads up. For the land you're going to possess is not like Egypt was. Number one, by the way, guess how big Egypt is? It's really big. If you take Texas and go 1.5 times bigger than Texas, well, that's about the size of the land of Egypt. Pretty big place. If you don't think Texas is big, just try to drive across it in one day. You know what I'm talking about if you've ever tried that. So it's a pretty big place. Now, the land of Israel is about the size of New Jersey or Massachusetts. It's a little bitty state. So number one, we've got a size difference. Also, a climate difference. The fact of Egypt is a desert place. The rainfall in Egypt is somewhere between 0.79 to 7.8 inches of rain annually. That's it. On a good year, they may have 7, maybe they have 8. On a bad year, they don't even get an inch of rain for an entire year. Y'all remember last year when we had the drought? Can you imagine what Louisiana would look like with 0.79 inches year after year? Well, that was the land of Egypt. 3.5% of the land is cultivated. 99% of the population of Egypt lives in the Nile Delta or in the Nile Valley. They had to be close to the river. If you weren't by the river, you literally couldn't live because there was no water. And so now, with that background, we come back to our scripture. The Lord is telling them, look, the land that you used to work in, where the water, you had to be close to the river. If you weren't close to the river, you literally were going to die. Only 3.5% of the huge land that you got could you actually live on. But you have to water it with your foot, and you had to sow the seed, and you had to very specifically design what you were going to put in your garden, in your herb garden in Egypt. And so the phrase watered with your foot kind of popped out at me, because I'll be honest, I don't think I've ever watered something with my foot. And so I did a little research, and nobody quite can tell me exactly what it is, but we came up with three things that they're pretty sure it was one of these. One of them was you went down to the river, you put your foot in there, you got some buckets, you picked them up, and you walked. Now that I have done. Walked to wherever the garden was, you walked, you poured it out, and then you went back and you got some more. Your feet. The other way that they thought of was that they were using pumps, and they were using engineered pumps, and they were using humans as the horsepower. Now, before you think that can't be possible, yeah, it can. There were some pretty smart dudes that built the pharaohs, pyramids and all that. Believe me, they had some really cool stuff. By the way, just for the record, with all of our modern technology, they still can't figure out how they did it. So I'm just saying that. So that's way number two, that there was some kind of machine that the slave labor, Israel, would power with their feet. They were pushing, and something was pushing the water up, and they would water it. Third possibility is you've got these canals where the water kind of comes from the river, and the water's always there, and you get your garden, everything, you plant your seed the way it is, and then you kind of go up with your feet and you kind of make a little mark there and let some water in, and then you kind of put your feet back and stop the water. Any way you look at it, you're going to get dirty, you're going to get hot, you're going to get sweaty, and it's going to take a lot of work to get your garden. Because without water, you ain't going to have much of a garden. But the land where you're going, now the Lord is saying that. But this land is not like that land. Because this land where you're going again to possess it, number one, it's yours. So when you get there, whoever's there has got to go. That'd be like me walking in Six Flags and say, hey, y'all out of here. I own this joint. Get out. That's a very different proposition than me coming saying, isn't that great? So the land where you're going to possess it is a land of hills and valleys. So it's not a flat plain. It's not a desert. There are desert places. There are hills. There are valleys. There are kind of hills, kind of valleys. You've got the sea. You've got all kind of stuff going on over there. And the word drinketh water of the heaven from verse 11 takes the word, and they have a little bit of fun with it. They talk about the word drinketh comes from the word you can use to imbibe, to banquet, to drink, drunkards, So the land where you're going, the promised land, where you're going, doesn't just like water. It really likes water. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So this is the land where you're going. It drinks the water of the rain of heaven. That means you don't have to get your bucket out. That means that the land of promise is different because you were in the land of Egypt. Now, where am I going with this? Canaan land is called the promise land. Any of you ever had a promise? So the promise land that you're going in isn't just something that you showed up at church and you saw it and you thought, this is great. Man, look what God's doing. But now I feel the Lord telling me that this is the promise that you are supposed to possess. That you leave the church with a promise and that the promise leaves with you. And that now it's not just a promise that I heard the preacher say. It's not just a promise that I read about in the book. It's not something that I can work up by my own self. But this is a promised land or a promise that God has given me and that God will take care of me. And so this land of promise, again, that I go in to possess. Now, when you possess something, it's yours. You can build a life on something that you possess. There gets to be a point in the promises and the word of God that not only do you possess it, it begins to possess you. That you begin to get in a wrestling match with God. And through the night, you're wrestling, God, I've got to have a promise. My brother's coming with 400 men, and he's going to kill me. And the last time I saw him, it didn't go so well. And you get a hold of that promise, and you begin to wrestle. After a while, the promise begins to change you. Because now when you start talking about a promise, your kids pop their heads up. Oh, I remember that. I remember when God healed so-and-so. I remember that it wasn't just something that happened at church and that we walked up and we saw somebody laying on hands. No, that happened to my mom or that happened to my sister. Or I remember my grandma talking about that. That happened to my family. And now I know that this is something that I can possess. But the water, let me tell you, God doesn't like us to come sipping a little bit of the water of the rain of heaven. Oh no, that ain't the way these promises go, honey. God says, when you come, get your belly full, baby. Untuck your shirt a little bit, let your belt out, and drink freely of the water of salvation. Because what I've got, you can get as much of it as you want. And you know how to get a promise? Do you know how to get a promise? We're going to talk about that. Verse 12, a land which the Lord thy God careth for. Or a promise that the Lord thy God careth for. For the eyes of the Lord are always upon it. I don't think some of you heard me. For the eyes of the Lord are always upon that promise that you've claimed. God, I know that I'm not well, and I know that I've been prayed for, and I know I haven't felt different, but I know that your word says I'm healed by the stripes, and the word says that I'm the head, I'm not the tail, and the word says that I'm more than a conqueror, and the word says that there was a little old woman who kept troubling a judge, and eventually he gave in, and I know that if I hold on to you, God, I know that you will come through. Because the promise or the promised land, will have the eyes of God on it. Where do we get promises from? We get them from the Word. That's the Word. When we latch a hold of the promise of God, we latch hold to the Spirit of God. We latch hold of who God actually is, the quality and the reputation of God. And God is concerned about his reputation. Let every man be a liar, but God's going to be true. You can stand when you got a promise of God. God's caring for his promise. Did the promise come when he gave it to Abraham? Did Abraham see it? He got up on a mountain and looked, and God showed him, hey, see all this? This is going to be yours and your kids. And then it seemed like nothing happened. Then Isaac was born. And God renewed that promise. Hey, Abraham, I haven't forgotten about my promise. My reputation is on the line here because I said I'm going to do something. And you can hold on and I'm going to do it. And Isaac was born. They still didn't possess the land. Oh, they were there, but the Bible calls them sojourners. They were there. They weren't citizens. They were just there. And then Jacob was born. And slowly the family began to build and oh, you talk about a mess. Can you imagine a house with four different wives, 13 kids, and one daddy? Now, come on. This beats anything the Kardashians ever put out. And where do you get that number? Well, there were 12 sons of Israel, and then there was a daughter. Best I can figure, that's 13. Leah, Rachel, Zilpah, and my goodness, I forgot the fourth one. There was another handmaiden there somewhere. So, drama, confusion. And now you're down in Egypt. And now you're slaves. And now the promise that you've been told, the promised land, ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost here. Ooh, the promised land that you've been told would be yours one day sure doesn't look like it when a taskmaster's beating you. When Moses shows up and Pharaoh says, you guys have too much time on your hand. I'll tell you what, I'm not even going to give y'all straw to make bricks, but you better make just as many bricks as you used to. You got too much time on your hands. And so everybody starts getting mad at Moses. And the reputation of God gets called in question. Did he or did he not say that this nation would have a promise? I'm here to tell you, friend, when you get a promise from God, whatever it is, when you're reading the Bible, when you're praying, when somebody's preaching, you feel that divine unction. You feel something that, hey, that's for me. You need to get a pen, paper, tablet, the back of your neighbor's bald head or something, and write it down. And put it down and don't let go of it. Because the promise of God now involves his reputation. Because he will not lie. He will not fail. And so, how do we possess a promise? Well, number one, you got to get a promise. And that's how you do it. You get a promise from God. Abraham got a promise from God. He talked with God. He walked with God. And God gave him a promise. Same thing happens here. You walk with God. Oh, God doesn't walk and talk with people. Oh, yes, he does. He was talking to me today. I was talking to him today. Did I see him? No, I don't want to make you think something spooky is going on. But as I talked to him, I'd feel scriptures coming in my head. And I always know, look, there's three voices that usually go in my head. Number one, I ate too many tacos. I got something crazy. Well, that ain't God. Number two, the enemy's trying to tell me something that accuses, he's the accuser of the brethren. So if you get a scripture that starts accusing somebody, well, you know, well, okay, it's a scripture, but God didn't put that in there. And so you got the other voice. The word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. It divides. It even reveals the thoughts and intents of our heart. So when you get a word, when you get a promise, when you get a promised land, I can't say this strong enough. I can't say this loud enough. I can't say this often enough. When you get a promise from God, you've got to hold on to it. Because to get you to your promise, God's gonna move you from where you are. You're gonna find yourself in situations that are way out of your comfort zone. I wanna be a soul winner. All of a sudden this a friend of mine told me they had prayed to be a soul winner. Then his wife got cancer. What's going on? But held on to the promise. I want to be a soul winner. I don't know how much time I have left on this world, but I want to be a soul winner. So when that person was over at MD Anderson in Houston going through their cancer treatments, they were able to share the light and the hope that we have hope not only in this life, but we have hope in another life. Whether I get taken today or 50 years from now, that I still have a hope and a promise that my soul, my future is insecure, that it's secure. And so through that cancer diagnosis, they began to win souls. It didn't look the way they thought it would in their nice little suburban little home and in the nice little city that they had thought of. No, baby, this land ain't like that land. When you get a hold of a promise of God, it's gonna change where you live. It's gonna change how you live. It's gonna change who you talk to. It's gonna change who your kids know and who they don't know. Listen, a promise of God is a promise. And you can stand on it. A lot of times we go through seasons. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord are upon the land of promise, or they're on the promise, and he cares for it. And they're always upon it from the beginning of the year, even unto the end of the year. Come on up, musicians, if you would. So whether you're going through a season of a drought, whether you're going through a season of spring, whether it's hot, whether it's cool, whether things are going really good in your life, whether things are going really bad in your life, when you hold on to a promise, when you hold on to a promise, it is not like the life that you have had before. It will change you. God's promise is throughout the year. So I don't feel like God heard me when I prayed for such and such. Well, you may be in wintertime, but God didn't change his promise. Don't you change your holding on. You see, there's power when you hold on to something. God's promise is multi-generational. Not only are you supposed to hold on to that promise till it comes fulfilled, whether it's fulfilled in you or whether it's fulfilled in your kids or their kids, you hold on to it. Because now your family is built on a promise of God. And it will change. That's how all of us are here. Because somewhere in your back history, you got a hold of what Holy Ghost can do. And you believe that the Holy Ghost could change your life. And I dare say, those of you, and I'm pointing, those of you and those of me, it's not good English, but you understand what I'm saying. When I got a hold of God's promise, it changed me. Before I figured I had a call to preach, I was the meanest little mischievous rascal Leesville had ever had. If there was something that was done wrong in that church, you didn't have to go look, and it was me or my friend. And either he did it or I did it or we did it or we knew about it. But somewhere at a church service, at a camp, at a youth camp, preacher got up, Brother Phil Muncy, and began talking about the different types of praise, and something got a hold of me. And something got in my heart, and I found a promise that I could get a hold of. And I found myself at an altar crying out for God to save me. Oh, I'd grown up in church. I'd been to the altar many times, but this time was different because I knew I had to have what this promise was, if you'd stand. I didn't need another sermon. I needed something that I could hold on to. And from that youth camp service years ago, as I look back, I can literally see building my life on Holy Ghost, building my life on a foundation, building my life, changing my family tree. Not only am I living, I have a wife that lives for God. I have children that live for God. We're changing the generations to come. We're changing the generations. That same thing is going to happen to you when you get a hold of the promise of God. It will change you. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, oh, I got to tell you about that. Because this isn't like that shaking a preacher's hand. This isn't like just come and after a while we're just going to call you part of the church family because you've come enough. This isn't like a country club. This isn't I've given enough tithes. No, this is a supernatural experience with God where God comes into you. And there is a not only can you feel something has happened, there is a physical response that the Holy Ghost begins to come upon you. And you, as you begin to pray, the Bible said the lips and your tongue begins to quiver. And before you know it, you're literally going to be speaking in another language. It is a supernatural promise of God that will absolutely change your life. If you don't have that, please come. We want to pray for you. We want you to experience that. We want you to experience a life that has changed, a life where you can go to sleep at night and not have to worry about a car alarm waking you up in the middle of the night and you're not sure or whatever. You know that you got God in your heart and that if something were to happen, you would be okay. If you've got problems that a doctor can't fix, I got a promise for you. Call upon the elders of the church, anoint with oil, lay hands on the sick, the prayer of faith, raise you up. God will heal you. You got problems that you can't get the bills paid, but my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. Well, it don't look like it. Well, are you holding on to the promise or aren't you? Man, I feel the Holy Ghost here. Promises, 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 promises. How many of you have got a hold of a promise? How many of you have received the Holy Ghost? Baptized in Jesus' name, spoke in another language. Look around. Come on, raise those hands. We overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So the land of Egypt, the land of slavery, hallelujah, come on up, let's pray. The land of Egypt, the land of slavery, what the devil meant for evil, God meant it for good. I don't see what good's coming out of this, getting my back beat. Oh, but you're multiplying. You're part of my plan. God, I don't understand this, but there's a promised land. I promised it to you. My reputation is at stake. I will perform it. I'm not a man that I would lie, neither the son of man that I should repent. Have I said it and shall I not do it? And have I spoken it and shall I not make it good? My reputation is on the line. If you got a promise, I want you to raise your hand. If you got a promise that you're holding on to that hasn't come to you yet, I want you to raise your hands. Father, I believe in the power of holding on. I don't know when, I don't know where, but I know your word said that you watch over your promise, that you watch over the land, that you water the promise. And so tonight this sermon is again putting water upon that promise, that you will perform your promise, that you are not slack concerning your word, that you will do what you said you will do. And so right now, Lord, we declare those promises, that in you they are yea and amen, that those promises, God, of revival, those promises of a healing, those promises of a loved one being saved, I hold on to that, God, and I believe you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's hold on to our promise. Hallelujah.
Thanks for joining our online worship experience. We hope it has been a blessing to you and your family.
We would love to connect with you. You can find us on Facebook, Instagram, or YouTube, or you can go to www.point.church and connect with us there.
If you'd like to partner with us in giving, you could download our app, or you could go to point.church and click give.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We look forward to worshiping with you again soon.